And as you know, we have been on this series talking about growing in God's love. Growing in God's love. And this week we're going to be talking about love's witness. Love's witness. I better turn up here. Make sure I got everything going here. Sorry for you guys online. I know there's so many things we have to do to this sound to get it to sound right online. So anyway, thank you for your patience. And and so tonight, as we have said, is that we have been talking about this growing in God's love. And we have believed that when we started this series, that the Lord's word to us, the Lord's challenge to us during this time is to challenge us to allow our love walk to grow, to allow the love that God has placed in us, to allow that to grow even more. As we see that, you know, we had talked about that, how, you know, the Lord, it was an encouragement and it wasn't a rebuke. Right? It wasn't saying that you're not doing it. He's just saying, let's grow. Let's do better. Amen. Let's step higher. Let's go farther than we have before. And let's allow the Lord to take you to places you've never been. Hallelujah. Amen. That's all good news. And so we have set our hearts to do that, to seek the Lord on revelation, knowledge about love, and growing in His love. Amen. And so that's all good stuff. Amen. We talked about already that the love that God has made us new creations, right? That He has poured out His love into our hearts. We see here, well, actually, it's the same kind of admonition that the Apostle Peter, Paul, gave to the church at Philippi. Come on, we're getting with it here. Apostle Paul gave the church at Philippi, and he says, I pray that your love may abound yet more and more and extend to its fullest development and knowledge and all keen insight, that your love may display itself in greater depth of acquaintance and more comprehensive discernment. And that means that's a bunch of fancy words saying that your love would increase, that the love of God that He put inside you would increase, would become brighter and become brighter and become brighter, and that it would be something, amen. I'm not going to get ahead of myself, all right? All right, praise God. Because I have this tendency, as I get to start going, and then I preach all my sermon in 5 minutes, and I skip everything, and then I have to go back through it. So, but amen. So it's a challenge for us that we grow more and more. And we have a desire in our hearts to grow more and more, do we not?
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. And so we see here, and we talked about this already, that God has put this love nature, His nature inside of us. We talked about the new creation and how God has made us new creatures in Christ Jesus. And that identity, the love and the identity of that new creation was love. Amen. And so love was part of our identity. Love is what we do. Love is what we're born to do. Love is our way of life. Hallelujah. And this was the greatest thing in the kingdom of God, was love. Love was the greatest. Love was greater than faith. Love was greater than knowledge. Love was greater than prosperity. Love was greater than all the promises of God. That love was the greatest. Hallelujah. Amen. So, and we see that God has poured out this love. He has poured out into our hearts this love. And it's time to let this love grow more and more. And if you remember last week, we set out to dispel one of the greatest lies that the devil has ever said to the church, has ever sold the church. And if you remember, this lie has caused more confusion, more division, more chaos in the church than any other lie. And this lie was that God is in control of everything, and that everything that happens in this world is the will of God. Somehow, mysteriously, it is the will of God. And we spent a lot of time dispelling that lie. And we dispelled that lie by two things. Well, quite a few things, actually. One was by the Word of God. We showed that if we rightly divide the Word of God, that is simply not true. And we also dispelled it by asking ourselves this one simple question. Is, have I done the will of God my whole life? From the day that I was born until now, at this day and this hour, have I done the will of God? And obviously that answer is no, right? Maybe you have, but I haven't. And so, you know what? Just that, just that fact that I haven't is proof that the will of God is not always done. Amen? And I know I've missed it a few times. And I know you guys are with me on that. I know you would say also that you have not been perfect and done the will of God your whole life. And so really, basically what we said is to say that everything that happens is the will of God is to say that you've never done anything but the will of God. And so that's obviously not true. That's obviously not true. We also said that if everything that happens is the will of God, then there is no such thing as a free will. Right? You cannot have God's will. You cannot have a free will if God's will is the only one being done. Right? So there is that is if that's true, then we only have a subjective will. Our will is subjective to His. But He has a will, and then He gave us a free will. He gave us a will of our own, whether to follow Him or not follow Him, whether to believe Him or not to believe Him, to whether live to follow light or to follow darkness. He gave us the choice. He gave us the free will. And then what we didn't cover last week, but we'll just cover it briefly today, is that God also says, right here in 2 Peter 3, verse 9, Apostle Paul, writing by the unction of the Holy Spirit, says, "The Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." So here we see the will of God being revealed, that none should perish, right? That all should come to repentance. That all should come to Christ, receive their repentance and their cleansing by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, you guys may know this, and I know I believe that many of you here do believe this, but I believe that this lie is prevalent in the church. And so you're going to run into somebody who does not believe that God is a good God. And you're going to run into people who believe that everything that happens in their lives, and I'm saying this with a fact. I'm not saying that maybe. You will. Because it is very prevalent in the church. And it's so important that we dispel this lie. And it's so important that we be equipped with the knowledge necessary to tell these people, to share with them the truth. Amen. Amen. And they need to know the truth. Because why? The truth, what? Sets you free. Sets you free. Amen. So now, and we also talked about, you know, a lot of people have decided that God is responsible for all the evil in the world because everything that happens is God's will. God is in control of everything. And we found out that the world was under a curse. And all the darkness, all the sickness and disease, all the things, the evil, the corruption, the lies, the murdering, the stealing, the killing, all those things were a result of the devil and the curse. Right? And so we went back and we looked at and we said, okay, well, is that God's will? Is the curse God's will? Is it His fault? And so to answer that question, we went back and we looked at Adam and Eve. Right? And we looked at, okay, well, how did the curse come into the world? If we're going to answer that question, is it God's fault? Is it God's plan that the earth is under a curse and that darkness rule and reign in this earth? And so we found out what brought the curse into the world, and we said that was sin. Sin is what brought the curse into the world. And so that's why we went back and looked at the beginning. We looked at Adam and Eve, and we saw that God stated His will. And His will, he said, do not eat of the fruit, right? That was God's will. And then God's will, what did He say? He also gave a warning along with His will. He warned Adam and Eve what would happen if they ate of the fruit. They warned Adam and Eve what would happen if they didn't listen, if they didn't follow His will, because they had a free will. And they chose not to follow His will. They chose not to listen to Him, and they sinned. Right? The devil had an influence in it, but they still had a free choice. And so they chose not to listen to God. They sinned against God, and the curse came into the world. Amen. Amen. So God not only told them their will, told them His will, but God also warned them. And so we see that it's clearly not God's will for sin or the result of sin, which is the curse. And so this world being under the curse, the killing, the stealing, the destroying, the sickness and disease, all those things. It's not God's will, never been God's will, not God's plan, never been God's plan. He doesn't want it. He despises it. He hates it. And he wants to free us from it. Amen. Hallelujah. That's God's will. That's God's will. So last time, what we didn't get into, we didn't get to finish last time because we ran out of time, but what we didn't get into is to explain and go more into why. Why is this the biggest lie that the devil has ever sold the church? Why is this the biggest one? Why do I say that? Why is it? And why is it so important that we spend this time dismantling this lie? And talk about that. Talk about it. It's important. It's important that we know. Not only that we know, but we're equipped with knowledge to help others. And one reason it's important, and one reason why it's this lie is the biggest lie, is because there's people out there that are hurting. They have gone through some terrible things. They have gone through turmoil. They have gone through really bad things. Some people have had their children die. They've had all sorts of things happen to them, abuses, physical abuse, sexual abuse, all those things. They've had some bad things happen to them. They've gone through some rough things in this life. And in their hurt and in their confusion, they can only blame God because they haven't heard the truth. And if we're blaming God for these things, if we're blaming, people have died from sickness and disease. People are struggling with illnesses of all, it doesn't have to be fatal, but it can be, whatever. You're struggling with things, and they need to know that if they believe that God is the cause of these things, then what is their hope for getting out of them? If God is the cause of your problems, what is your hope of getting out of those problems? If the God sent the sickness and disease to you and put it on you, what is your faith? Where is your confidence going to be in him getting you out of it? It's not going to be very strong. You're not going to have, you cannot have faith in God if you don't know his will. If you think it's his will for you to be sick, the best you can do is hope that you can change his mind and hope that he will bring you out of it. Right? So that's why it's a destructive lie. Because the devil wants you to blame God. The devil wants you to accuse God for the bad things that have happened in your life, the things that you've gone through in life, the difficult times that you've gone through in life, all the challenges that you have faced in life. He wants you to blame God because God is your way out. God is your way through. And if you're blaming him, you're not going to turn to him, and you cannot have faith in him to get you out of it. Amen. So you're stuck. You're in bondage, right? Yeah. You cannot move. You cannot be freed because you're blaming God. And he's lied to you. Praise God. That's why we need to dispel this lie, that it's not God's will. It's not God's plan that you went through that. Amen. It's not his plan. It's not what he wanted. And why did it happen? Because you have a free will, and people have a free will on this earth. Now, I want to say something because the devil kind of has an opportunity here to sow fear. And when we say that God is not in control of everything, we're not saying that God is not in control of anything. That's right. There's a difference. Right. All right? And I've been instructed not to go into this too much because I could go off here and I can spend hours here. Right? But the Bible says that if we break it down and you study the Word of God, it says that God is only in control of what you give him control over. God is only in control of what you give him control of. Yes. Amen. So if you have a problem, if you have a struggle, and you have something that's weighing you down, a burden, what does he say? Give it to me. Right? Cast the whole of your cares. Cast your burdens upon me, and I will sustain you. Psalm 55, verse 22. Amen. And maybe that's a word for another time. But just because God is not in control of everything doesn't mean there's no help. Doesn't mean there's no grace. Doesn't mean there's no deliverance. Doesn't mean there's no protection. Hallelujah. It's all there. Hallelujah. But we just have to learn to do it his way and learn how to do it right. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. And the first thing that we have to do is get that thought out of our heads, get that belief system out of our heart that God is the cause of my problems, that God is the cause of my sickness, that God is the cause of what I'm going through. We have to get it out of there. Because if you don't get it out, you'll never be able to heal. You'll never be able to heal. Amen. Because it takes the grace of God to heal. And the second reason we want to dispel this lie, and the second reason why this lie is so destructive, because it robs God of his true identity. It robs God of his true character, of what he really is like. We see in the Word of God, 1 John 4, verse 8 says, "But if anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love." And so how are we going to minister to people? How are we going to tell people that God is a God of love and then turn around and say God is in control of everything and everything that happens in this world is his will? Well, if you look at this world, that's not in very good shape. And a lot of Christians have left the faith. They have left the Christianity. They have left God because they believe that God is in control, and their son died, or their daughter died, a friend died, or whatever, something terrible happened in their life, and they blame God for it, because we're preaching and we're teaching that God is in control of everything, and the truth is he's not. And so they've been deceived to leave the faith. That's why it's a destructive lie. That's why it's a destructive lie, and it robs God not only of his identity, but it robs God of his children. It robs God of his children. Now you're beginning to see why it's so hateful and destructive, the greatest lie that the devil has ever sold the church. How will you tell the world that God is love if he's responsible for everything that's happening in this world? What will the world's response be? Amen. Praise God. But when we begin to see the truth, and when we begin to share the truth, and when we begin to believe the truth through rightly dividing the Word of God, we begin to see a different story. We said this last week. A different story unfolds. God saw us in our fallen state. It wasn't his plan. It wasn't his will. It's not what he wanted. But he saw us. We were lost. Lost in darkness, without hope, without rescue, no chance of coming out of it, except for if God did something. And God did something. And the reason why he did it was not obligation, not because he had to. The reason he did it was because he loved us. He loved us. For God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world that he gave his only one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes and trusts in him as Savior shall not perish, but have eternal life. Hallelujah. He came and rescued us. He came and saved us. He came and healed us. He came and delivered us. He rescued us from the domain of darkness. He rescued us from our sins and our failures and our mistakes. He came to set us free. Hallelujah. And he saved us, and it was of something of his own doing that he chose to do because of love. Love compelled him to act. He could not sit by and watch his creation be lost for eternity. He had to do something. He wanted to do something. It was his will to do something. If anything was his will, it was his will to rescue us. If anything was his will, it was his will to heal us. If anything was his will, it was his will to deliver us. Hallelujah. From anything that might steal or kill or destroy. And not only that, not only did he redeem us through the blood of Christ and through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, but he also set us with Christ in heavenly places. Far above all the principalities and powers of might and rule and dominion. So not only did he rescue us, but he set us above it. And what does that mean, that we're sitting above it? That we, that no longer should sin have dominion over you, for you are under grace and not under the law. Not only shall the devil shall not have dominion over you, for you're under grace and not under the law, but now seated with Christ, you have dominion over them.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. God set you in Christ far above those principalities in the heavenly places, so you could rule and reign over the devil. You could rule and reign over sin and all those things that seek to kill and to steal and destroy in your life, that you would rule over them. You would be triumphant over them. Hallelujah. Through him. Hallelujah. Not in our own power, not in our own might, but through him, through Christ. What did Jesus say? You have tribulation. You'll have trial. You'll have tests in this world, but he didn't stop talking there. He kept going. He says, but be of good cheer. What does that mean? The story's not over. I'm not finished with my sentence. What does he say? That I have overcome the world. So I have overcome sickness and disease. I have overcome those tests and trials. I have overcome everything that you will face in this life. Jesus said, I have overcome them. And he says that we rule and reign in him, with him. So if we're with him, that we rule and reign over everything that would face and come against us in this life.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
That's the truth.
Thank you, Lord.
That's the truth.
Thank you, Lord.
That's the love of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. That's how you get free, is together with him. Together with him. Hallelujah. All right. And the main reason, this is what I believe the Lord is wanting us to get to. The main reason for the purpose of this series, and that's why we're spending so much time here, and this is the main, another reason why the devil's lie that God is in control of everything is so destructive, is because it robs the church of its witness. It robs the church of its witness. The love of God is a witness to the world.
Yes.
And this witness is that God is true and that God is love. And God has chosen that this witness be expressed through his church. That this love and his truth be revealed to the world through his body, through his church. You see here, Romans 2 verse 4, it says, or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing it's the what? The goodness of God that leads you to repentance. How are we going to sell the world on the goodness of God if we're blaming God for all the evil in this world? How in the world are we going to be a witness to the love of God and the goodness of God if we're saying that everything that happens is God's will? That includes the killing of your son or your daughter or the killing of whatever. If God is responsible for all that. So you begin to see how the devil has convinced us. And I'm actually surprised how widespread this lie is. And I think it's been through millennia of religion that the devil has been working this lie for a long time in the church. And it's time to get rid of it. And it's time to start telling people the truth. That no, it's not God's will that you be sick. It's God's will that you be healed. It's not God's will that you be broke. No, it's God's will that you be prosperous.
Amen.
And blessed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's not God's will that you be tied up in depression and suffering and bondage.
Amen.
No, it's God's will that you be free and rejoicing and full of joy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's God's will. That's God's will. Hallelujah. Amen. But we also see this here in Luke 7, verse 47. Jesus Christ here is speaking about a woman that came to him, poured the anointing oil over his feet, and started wiping his feet with her hair. You guys remember that story?
Yeah.
And he said, and the Pharisees began to question him, and he said to them, therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little. So what are we seeing here? That someone who loved much, someone who was forgiven much, someone who understands that it was the mercy and the compassion and the grace of God and the love of God that saved him from hell, that saved him from destruction, that saved him from the devil, that saved him from sickness and disease. That if someone begins to understand that it was the mercy of God, and only the mercy of God, and the compassion of God, and only the compassion of God, that they were forgiven of all their sins, of all the things that they have done in their life. When they realize that, and they understand that, then they love much. But a church that doesn't believe, that believe that God is causing evil, that God is destroying, that God is making people sick, a church that believes that, they don't forgive. How can they be forgiven that they haven't been forgiven of a lot? because they're blaming God for it, right? They're blaming God for it. And notice, if you're blaming God for all those things, you love little. You love little. The church loves little when it doesn't understand and it doesn't believe or doesn't realize the love that God has for it. And so the devil has sold it this lie to rob us, to get the church to love little, to have little compassion, to have little mercy. Am I not right? Is that right? Would that be a fair way to interpret these scriptures? And so that's why the devil works so hard to sell us that lie. Because love, the love of God, is a light to the world. The love of God is the witness of the church to the world that God is true and that God is good. And if the devil can rob that of them, there's little witness. There's little witness. Amen. So if you're wondering how to witness to somebody and you're not sure, you know, I don't want to kind of, you know, invade in their lives. I don't want to pour a bunch of scriptures down their throat. I don't want to force them. I don't want to argue with them. How do I witness to somebody? You love them. You love them.
Right.
Love them with the word of God. Love is the greatest witness. Hallelujah. Yeah. Love will set people free. Love will see, people will begin to see, the world will begin to see, when they see the love of God in you, and they see the love of God displayed through you, they will begin to see the goodness of God. And that goodness of God will bring them to repentance. Hallelujah. And they will receive the love of God for themselves. Hallelujah. Amen. So let's not be robbed anymore. Amen. Let's not let the devil rob us anymore. Because I've been there myself at times, right? Where you've gone through some struggles and you say, Lord, why am I going through this? You know, the tendency is to blame God. But we need to learn to pull back and say, wait a minute. God is not my problem. God is my solution. God is not the cause, but God is my way out. God is my way through. Hallelujah. And so I'm not going to fall into that devil's trap. And I'm no longer going to listen to the devil and let him tell me that this is God's plan, that this is God's purpose. I know some people have even said, well, there were some good things that came out of it. You know, if this bad thing didn't happen in my life, then this good thing would have never happened. But I want to tell you, all right? And I want to put forth for your considerance, because I don't want to be argumentative, I don't want to be rude, but there's another possibility that God did not cause the evil thing in your life in order to teach you a lesson. But maybe God is so good at combating evil that when he sees that evil happening in your life, he is working good. Hallelujah. He is so good at working good. He's so good at combating evil with good. And so when that evil thing happened in your life and the good thing that followed, it was God combating the evil. He was saying, I'm taking the evil. I see this evil that's operating in your life, but I'm going to step in because I'm good and because I'm love. I'm going to show you the goodness of God. I'm going to show you the love of God. I'm going to show you the way out. And because you followed him through it, the good thing happened.
Amen.
The good thing happened. Hallelujah. God is so good at combating evil and bringing good things out of evil things that people think that it's God who brought the evil things.
That's good.
Do I need to say that again? I'll say that again. People believe, I believe that God is so good at turning evil things into good things that people believe that God caused the evil thing. He's so good at it. That's how good he is. Hallelujah. Amen.
Wow.
That's how much he wants to bring the goodness into your life. He wants you to see and experience and to know his goodness and his love and his mercy for you. Hallelujah. Amen. He wants you not only to know it, he wants you to experience it, and he wants you to believe it. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. So we're going to take communion. And you know that here in let me go through this real quick. John 13, verse 34 through 35, Jesus talking about here, he says, "No, so now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. You should love, so should you love each other." Here it is. Your love for one another will what? Prove to what?
The world
that you are my disciples. So the love that God has for you, and the love that you show for one another, to people in the church, Now, I believe this is also for people in the world. It is what? It will prove to the world. It'll be a witness to the world that God is love, and that God is true, and that God is good, that you are his disciples. Amen. All right, praise God. Now we're going to take communion. Amen. And here in Luke 22, verse 19 through 20, it says, Jesus Christ again speaking, he says, he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, what I want to point out here is this remembrance of me. Jesus told us, when we take communion, do this in remembrance of me. And so what I want to do today, what I feel led to do today, is when we take communion, and what we're going to do is we're going to take the elements, but then we're going to play a short song after, and then we'll be dismissed, okay? But when we take communion, put yourself in remembrance of what God has done for you. Not only sending Jesus Christ to this earth to die for your sins, but what about that time when he forgave you? What about that time he had mercy on you? What about that time he helped you? What about that time he healed you? What about that time he came when you needed help, that he was there to help you? Amen? What about that time? What are all those times? Put yourself in remembrance and then tell him thank you. And the reason you want to tell him thank you, I know it seems kind of obvious, but you have to understand, when we understand that God only did that for you because he loved you. He loves you. He loves you. That's the hardest thing to sell people in the church. God loves you. He cares about you. He cares about what you go through. He cares about the suffering that you've had in your life. And he wants to heal it. Amen. He wants to set you free. He wants to deliver you from it all. He wants you to celebrate life, to enjoy life. And we can't do that if we're hanging on to the past. Amen. So we're going to go ahead. We're just going to pray. And let's go ahead and let's take the bread here. If I can get this thing open without spilling it all over the place. All right. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Father, we give you glory. We bless you. We honor you. And Father, today we put ourselves in remembrance. We put ourselves in remembrance of the love that you've had for us. It was because you loved us that you sent Jesus Christ. It was because you loved us that by his stripes that we are healed. It was because you loved us that you broke the body of Jesus Christ. You broke his body so that our body may be made whole. And so, Father, we take this elements today in remembrance of your Son, Jesus Christ, who you sent on our behalf. We bless you in Jesus' name. You may break the bread and partake. And Father, we also thank you for this cup, which represents the blood of Jesus, which was shed for our sakes, that was shed for on our behalf, that we would be forgiven of every single sin, that every failure would be wiped, clean, gone forever because of the blood of Jesus. And Father, we take this blood, we partake of this cup in thanksgiving and in praise for your love for us. We give you glory, we give you honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Take your little cup. Leave you with this last thing. Our ability to forgive, our capacity to forgive, solely rests upon our knowledge of knowing how much we've been forgiven. Again, our capacity to forgive one another and walk in love with one another solely rests on the capacity that we know that God has forgiven us. In other words, why am I forgiving someone that I can't stand? Why am I forgiving somebody that I want to slap? It's because I've been forgiven much. I have been released of a great debt. And so I can release my brothers and sisters of a little debt. Amen? Jesus taught that. Well, maybe we'll get into it next time. I don't know. I felt in my heart to say it. So God bless you guys. Thank you for coming. Have a great and blessed week. We'll see you next time.